soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up.
Hey guys, so today I would like to do a video on the clinical correlates of the upper limb. So ideally, I'll start with the nerve injuries to your upper limb, that is the main nerves, that is your radial nerve, the median nerve, as well as your ulnar nerve. Then as time goes on, I'll also include the axillary nerve and things like serotonin paralysis, as well as the muscular cutaneous nerve that you'll then be using to test for the biceps reflex and it. So we'll start with the radial nerve. So you're going to find that injuries to the radial nerve, they're going to be common at three different sites. One of those is going to be the axilla, then the spiral groove, or at the elbow joint. So if you're going to have injury to the radial nerve within the axilla, you're going to have different sensory and motor manifestations that will be different from injury to the radial nerve within your spiral groove or at the level of the elbow joint. So that's going to be referred to as crutch palsy, because you may have pressure being applied to the radial nerve within the axilla for people who actually be using crutches, right? So these people, they're going to lose extension at the elbow joint because the triceps muscle is going to be affected. So remember, the triceps is going to have three heads: a long head, a medial head, and a lateral head. The nerve to the long head and the nerve to the medial head, they're going to be given within the axilla. Then the nerve to the lateral head, and as well as another branch, the medial head, they're going to be given within the spiral groove. So you're going to lose most of the triceps fibers. So you're going to have weakness in extension of the elbow. Then you're also going to have loss of extension at the wrist. So that's going to present as wrist drop, right? Then you're also going to lose extension of the digits, because you're going to lose the extensor digitorum, which is going to be a mass of your posterior compartment, as well as the extensor indices and the extensor digiti minimi, as well as the extensor pollicis longus. Then you're going to lose, you're going to have loss of supination in an extended elbow, because you're going to find that the supinator and brachioradialis muscles, they're actually going to be paralyzed, but you'll be able to supination will actually become possible if you're going to flex. That's when you can now bring into play your biceps brachii, which is your main supinator, right? Then in terms of sensory loss, you're going to lose skin sensations over the posterior surface of the arm, as well as sensory loss of the narrow strip on the back of the forearm, as well as losing sensory sensations on the dorsum of your hand. You're also going to lose sensory sensations over the skin that is beyond your deltoid muscle on the lateral side, because remember, the skin over the upper half of your deltoid will be supplied by your supraclavicular nerves. Then the skin over the lower half of the deltoid will be supplied by an upper lateral cutaneous nerve, which will be a branch of your axillary nerve. Then the skin that goes beyond the deltoid incision on the lateral side will then be innervated by that lower lateral cutaneous nerve, which will be a branch of the radial nerve. So you're more likely going to lose that. Then if you're going to have injury to the radial nerve within the spiral groove or your radial groove, this is going to be due to maybe a mid-shaft fracture, or you actually have direct pressure being applied on the radial nerve. So that's referred to as serotonin paralysis, mainly in people who would have been drunk and then they sleep in an improper way, right? So these people, they're going to most commonly injure the radial nerve in the distal part of the groove. So you'd find that that would be beyond the origin of the nerves that are actually going to your triceps muscle. So you're still going to have extension at the elbow joint, right? But you're going to lose extension of the wrist and the fingers, and your wrist will still drop, because the brachioradialis and the extensor carpi radialis are long as the muscles of the lateral compartment of your forearm, they will not be patent. So you find that if you're going to have a lesion at the level of the elbow joint, those muscles can actually be patent, because the fibers would have been given already. So you can actually maintain your wrist in a normal anatomic position, right? And you're also going to have loss of supination when the arm is extended, right? Then the sensory loss will be restricted only to a variable small area over the dorsum of the hand between the first and the second metacarpals, right? So you have extension of the elbow still being possible, but it can actually be weak because the nerves to the long and the lateral heads of the triceps, they arise in the axilla before the site of the lesion, right? Then if you're going to have injury of the radial nerve at the elbow, that may be referred to as radial tunnel syndrome, right? So this is an entrapment neuropathy of a deep branch of the radial nerve at the elbow. So the compression of the radial nerve at the elbow may be caused by the following four structures. You may have fibrous bends or an arcade of Frosse, sharp tendinous margin of extensor carpi radialis brevis, or a leash of vessels from the radial recurrent artery, right? So these people are going to have loss of extension of the wrist and the fingers, but the wrist will not drop because remember you still have the brachioradialis and the extensor carpi radialis longus, which will be muscles of the lateral compartment of your forearm, and they're actually going to be supplied by the main radial nerve before it divides into a superficial branch and a deep branch. The deep branch is the one that will then pierce your supinator muscle, and it's going to supply the supinator muscle as well as the extensor carpi radialis brevis, then continue as your posterior interosseous nerve that will supply the rest of the muscles, right? Then you're going to have pain over the extensor aspect of the forearm. Then moving on, we can now talk about the injuries to the median nerve, right? So you're going to find that lesions to the median nerve can actually occur at four different sites, and one of those will be at the elbow joint as it passes through your cubital fossa, then in the mid forearm, in the wrist, or in the carpal tunnel, right? So it's going to have different clinical presentations. So you'd find that injury of the median nerve at the elbow can be injured due to supracondylar fractures together with the brachial arteries that are passing through your cubital fossa. Or you may have application of a tight tourniquet during vena puncture, or entrapment of the nerve as it passes through the two heads of pronator teres muscle to gain access to the forearm. Right. Remember, the median nerve is going to supply most of the muscles of the anterior compartment of the forearm, as well as its anterior interosseous branch is going to supply the deeper muscles. Of course, the ulnar nerve will supply your flexor carpi ulnaris and the major half of your flexor digitorum profundus. Right. So the characteristic clinical features for this is your forearm is going to be kept in the supine position because you're going to lose pronation, because you're going to paralyze the chief pronator, which is your pronator teres. Then you're also going to lose more distally your pronator quadratus, right? Then you're going to have wrist flexion that is going to be weak due to paralysis of all the flexors of the forearm, but you're going to spare the major half of the flexor digitorum profundus as well as the flexor carpi ulnaris, right? Then adduction of the wrist. Due to the fact that you'd have paralyzed flexor carpi radialis, right? And you're going to have anopost action of flexor carpi ulnaris and the major half of the flexor digitorum profundus, the wrist is going to be adducted. Right. Then no flexion is going to be possible at the interphalangeal joints of the index and the middle fingers. Right. Then the time that is known as benediction deformity of the hand. So when a patient tries to make a fist, right, the index and the middle fingers are going to remain straight due to paralysis of both the superficial and the deep flexors of those fingers, right, leading to loss of flexion at both the PIP and the DIP joints at your proximal interphalangeal and your distal interphalangeal joints, right? So the ring and little finger can be kept in a flex position due to intact nerve supply of the medial half of your flexor digitorum profundus. So you can actually move those to make a fist, but the other two will actually not be able to flex, right? Then you're also going to have loss of flexion of the terminal phalanx of the thumb due to paralysis of your flexor pollicis as long as, right? Then there's something that is known as epthumb deformity, right? And in this deformity, the thinner eminence is going to be flattened and the thumb is laterally rotated and adducted due to paralysis of the muscles of the thinner eminence. And whilst the adductor pollicis is going to remain patent because it's actually going to be supplied by the ulnar nerve. Remember, the muscles of the hand, they're actually going to be 20, and of those 20, 5 are going to be supplied by The median nerve, whilst 14 are going to be supplied by the deep branch of the ulnar nerve, then one that is superficial, that is your palmaris brevis, actually going to be supplied by the superficial branch of the ulnar nerve, right? Then you may have injury of the median nerve at the mid forearm, right? That's going to result in pointing index finger due to paralysis of the radial head of the flexor digitorum superficialis, right? Then injury to the median nerve at the wrist, that's in the distal forearm, right? Going to find that you're going to injure the median nerve and its palmar cutaneous branch, right? That is going to be different from a carpal tunnel syndrome because the palmar cutaneous branch is going to be spared, but it's actually going to pass above the flexor retinaculum, just lateral to your palmaris longus tendon, right? So injury of the median nerve at the wrist, you're going to have loss of sensation on the lateral part of the palm, including that over the thinner eminence and the lateral 3.5 digits, right? Then you also have epthumb deformity because you're going to have paralysis of your thinner muscles, right? Then injury to the in the carpal tunnel is going to present with something that is known as carpal tunnel syndrome. So the median nerve is injured in the carpal tunnel due to its compression there, right? So the carpal tunnel is formed by the anterior concavity of your carpus, and it's actually conveyed into a tunnel by your flexor retinaculum, which is going to span from the medial side, from the pisiform and the hammett, to the lateral side on your scaphoid and your trapezium, right? So the tunnel is tightly packed with 9 long flexor tendons of the fingers and the thumb with their surrounding synovial sheath and the median nerve. Remember, the flexor digitorum superficialis and the profana, they're going to share a common sheath, whilst the flexor retinaculum is going to separate to enclose your flexor carpi radialis tendon, right? So the median nerve can actually get compressed within this tunnel due to a lot of pathological conditions, to include myxedema. We may have tenosynovitis of the flexor tendons, osteoarthritis, and so forth, right? So the clinical features of this, going to have feeling of a burning pain or pins and needles along the sensory distribution of the median nerve, that is your lateral 3.5 digits, especially at night. But you're going to spare the skin over the thinner eminence because the palmar cutaneous branch, as we said, was going to be traveling above your flexor retinaculum, just lateral to the tendon of the palmaris longus muscle. It's actually going to be given within the forearm. So it's actually going to be separate from the nerve now, right? Then you have weakness of the thinner muscles. Then you may have epthumb deformity if left untreated, right? Then injury to the ulnar nerve. The ulnar nerve is commonly injured at two sides, that is at the elbow as well as at the wrist, right? So injury at the elbow, the nerve can, remember, it's actually going to pierce the intermuscular septum within the region of the arm at the level of the incision of your coracobrachialis. It's going to go to the posterior compartment together with the superior ulnar collateral artery. Then it's actually going to emerge behind your medial epicondyle. So you can actually be injured in dislocations of the medial epicondyle. If you're going to have thickening of the fibrous roof and of the cubital tunnel, that is your cubital fossa, that's in cubital tunnel syndrome, where you may have compression as it passes between the two heads of the flexor carpi ulnaris, which is one of the muscles of the forearm is actually going to supply, right? So in such cases, you may have atrophy and flattening of the hypothenar eminence because the ulnar nerve is going to supply the muscles of the hypothenar eminence, that's your abducted digiti minimi, your flexor digiti minimi, and the opponent's digiti minimi, right? Then you may have claw and deformity affecting the ring and the little fingers, right? The first phalanges of these fingers are extended, right? And the middle and distal phalanges, they're actually going to be flexed, right? That will be different from the actions of the lumbrical muscles of those fingers, right? Then it is not a true claw hand. I'll talk about a true claw hand in the subsequent pages. Then you have loss of abduction and adduction of the fingers because the ulnar nerve is going to supply your palmar interossei as well as your dorsal interossei. Right. Then you have flattening of the hypothenar eminence. Then you have loss of adduction of the thumb because you're going to affect the nerve supply of the adductor pollicis, which is just lying deep to your opponent's pollicis on the thinner side. Then you have loss of sensation over the palma and the dorsal surface of the medial third of the hand and the medial 1.5 fingers. Right. So in injury to the ulnar nerve, the foment sign is positive, but if you're going to look at injuries of the median nerve, you're going to have a positive Tinel sign and a Phalen's test. Right? Then you may have injury of the ulnar nerve at the wrist. So the ulnar nerve is also commonly injured at the wrist, right? Due to the superficial position of the ulnar nerve at the site, or it may be compressed within the Guyon's canal, that is also referred to as a piso-hammer tunnel that is going to be formed by the gap between the pisiform and the hammet, which is going to be grooved by a piso-hammet ligament, or rather bridged by a piso-hammet ligament, right? So you may have claw and deformity affecting the ring and the little fingers. That's an ulnar claw, right? Then it is more pronounced because the flexor digitorum profundus is not paralyzed. Therefore, there is marked flexion rather of your distal interphalangeal joints, right? Suppose remember the flexor digitorum profundus will actually have been supplied within the forearm, right? Then you may have atrophy and flattening of the hypothenar eminence. Then you have loss of abduction and adduction because of the interossei muscles. Then you foment sign is also positive in injury to the ulnar nerve at the wrist. Right. Then as for a complete claw hand, you're going to find that the combined lesions of the median and the ulnar nerves at the elbow, they're going to cause a complete or a true claw hand deformity, which is going to have the following characteristic features. So you're going to have hyperextension of the wrist and the metacarpophalangeal joints, whilst you have flexion of your interphalangeal joints. Right. So generally, injuries of the upper limb can be classified into dislocations, fractures, nerve injuries, right? That's that. But we'll go deeper with some of those aspects as we go on with the video, right? So you may have sites for intramuscular and intravenous injections within the upper limb. So intramuscular injections can actually be done within your fasciae muscles in children, or it can be done within your gluteus medius, and then the gluteal region, which can actually be done within the deltoid, but it's commonly done in the lower half of the deltoid to avoid injuring the axillary nerve. Because remember, your axillary nerve is going to supply the deltoid muscle, which is going to be your main abductor, and it's also going to supply the teres minor, and it's going to supply the skin over the lower half of the deltoid, right? Then intravenous injections are most commonly given in the superficial veins of the front of the elbow. That's your median cubital vein that is going to join the lateral cephalic vein to the medial basilic vein, right? And they can also be done on the dorsum of the hand, right? Then you can also feel atrial pulsations within your upper limb, right? So the atrial pulsation is most commonly felt and auscultated on the medial side of the front of the elbow for recording of blood pressure, right? So at that side, you're actually checking for the brachial pulse, right? Then as for bone fractures, you find that fractures of the clavicle are going to be very common at the junction of the medial third and the lateral third and the medial third, or you can say the lateral third and the medial two-thirds, right? The reason is because that is the weakest site than the two curvatures of your clavicle. They actually meet at that point, because remember your clavicle is going to be S-shaped, right? Then the transmission of forces from the clavicle to the scapula occur at the site through your coracoclavicular ligament. So that's the most commonly fractured site, right? Then you may have congenital anomalies, and one of those is something that is known as clavicular dystososis, right? So the clavicle is a long bone that forms by both intramembranous ossification and endochondral ossification. So you may have failure of fusion of the two primary centers of ossification. They're going to have a condition that is known as clavicular dystososis. Then cleidocranial dystososis will be a condition now that is characterized by partial or complete absence of your clavicle. It's actually going to be associated with defective ossification of your skull bones. So that's going to be a defect within the a defect that is going to come or arise due to a defect in the molecular regulations, or actually the DNA makeup that is going to be responsible for the formation of those bones. Then something that is known as Sprengel's deformity of the scapula. So that's a congenital high scapula that you're actually going to find within the neck region, right? Then the nerves are directly related to your humerus are going to be your radial nerve, your axillary nerve, as well as the ulnar nerve, right? The ulnar nerve that is behind the medial epicondyle. Then the axillary nerve will be just medial to your sagittal neck. Then the radial nerve will be within that spiral groove together with your profunda brachii artery, right? Then fractures of the humeral shaft are common, and displacement of the fragments depend on the relation of the site of the fracture of the insertion of the deltoid muscle. So if you're going to have fractures proximal to the deltoid tuberosity, you're going to find that the proximal segment will actually be adducted by the latissimus dorsi, pec major, and the teres major, while the distal segment is going to be pulled upwards by the deltoid, the biceps, and the triceps. But if you're going to have fractures distal to the deltoid tuberosity, the proximal segment is actually going to be abducted, whilst the distal segment is going to be pulled upwards by your triceps and the biceps muscle. Then fractures of the humeral head can occur during the process of anterior and posterior dislocations of your shoulder joint, and the greater tuberosity of the humerus can be fractured by direct trauma or displaced by the glenoid labrum during dislocation of the shoulder joint, or it can actually be avulsed during violent contractures of your supraspinatus muscle. That is going to be one of the muscles that is going to insert on your greater tuberosity. Remember, from above it's supraspinatus, infraspinatus, then you find the teres minor more inferiorly. Right. Then the sagittal neck of the humerus, which lies immediately distal to your lesser tuberosity, can be fractured by a direct blow on the lateral aspect of the shoulder, right? Or in an indirect manner by falling on your outstretched hand. So falling on an outstretched hand can also injure your clavicle, because remember, you're going to have transmission of forces. Right. Then fractures of the radius. The radius is going to be a weight-bearing bone of the forearm, and fractures of the radius are more common than those of the ulna, right? So in fractures, a shaft of the radius, with the fracture line below the insertion of the biceps and above the insertion of the pronator teres. So if you're going to be below the insertion of the biceps, but above the insertion of pronator teres, the upper fragment is going to be supinated by the supinator. Then the lower fragment will be pronated by the pronator teres. And so that's when you're actually below the insertion of the biceps, but above the insertion of pronator teres. Right. So in fractures of the distal end of the radius, the distal fragment can be displaced backwards and upwards, producing a Dina Fok deformity. That's going to be Colles fracture. The reverse of Colles fracture, where you have anterior displacement, is going to be referred to as Smith's fracture. Then fracture of the styloid process of the radius will be referred to as Schoffer's fracture, right? Then there's something that is known as Madelung's deformity, which is a congenital anomaly of the radius, which presents with the following clinical features. So you're going to have an anterior bowing of the distal end of the radius due to an abnormal growth of a distal epiphysis. So when the elbow is going to be fully extended, you're going to find that the tip of the olecranon process, the medial and the lateral epicondyles of the humerus, they're all going to lie in the same horizontal plane, right? But when your elbow is going to be fully flexed, these three bony points, they're going to form an equilateral triangle, right? So if you're going to have dislocation of the elbow, this relationship is going to be disturbed. So that can be a diagnostic too, right? Then the ulna stabilizes the forearm by gripping the lower end of the humerus by its trochlear notch and provides foundation for the radius to produce supination and pronation at the superior and inferior radial ulna joints, right? Then there's something that is known as Montenegro's fracture and Galeazzi's fracture. So Montenegro's fracture is going to be a fracture of the ulna, whilst Galeazzi's fracture is going to be a fracture of the radius, right? But get this. In Montenegro's fracture, you're going to injure the upper shaft of the ulna, right? But you're going to have dislocation of the radial head at the superior radial ulna joint. Galeazzi's fracture, you're going to injure the lower third of the shaft of the radius, but you're going to have dislocation at the inferior radial ulna joint, right? Then a fracture of the shaft of the ulna due to direct injury, when a night watchman reflexively raises his forearm to ward off the blow of the stick, is termed a night stick fracture, right? So that's a fracture of the shaft of the ulna. The something that is known as scaphoid fracture. That is the most common fracture of the carpus, and you can actually palpate scaphoid fracture within the anatomic snuff box. Right. Then Bennett's fracture is going to be an oblique fracture of the base of the first metacarpal, right? So it is an intra-articular and maybe associated with subluxation or dislocation of the metacarpal. Then Boxer's fracture, it most commonly occurs or involves the neck of the fifth metacarpal, right? Then as for the clinical correlates for the pectoral region, you may have congenital anomaly of the pectoralis major that can be referred to as Poland syndrome. Then remember prune belly syndrome, you lose your rectus abdominis muscles. That's a congenital problem. Then paralysis of the serratus anterior, you're going to injure the long thoracic nerve, which is going to be the nerve that is going to supply the serratus anterior muscle, right? Which can actually be injured during removal of the breast, of a breast tumor in someone who has breast cancer, that's in red gum mastectomy, right? So protraction of the scapula is weakened, then the inferior angle and the medial border of the scapula become unduly prominent, right? Particularly when you ask your patient to push his hands against the wall. So the scapula is going to bulge outwards like a wing, right? Then you may have metastasis of breast cancer to the brain, from the posterior intercostal veins to the vertebral venous plexus, then to the intracranial jugular sinus within the brain, then to the brain tissue, right? So breast cancer is one of the most common cancers in females that everyone knows, and it's going to arise from epithelial cells of the lactiferous duct side. In about 60% of the cases, it occurs in the upper lateral quadrant and commonly affects females between 40 and 60. Right? So you may have a presence of a painless hot lump. We may have the breast becoming fixed and immobile. You have retraction of skin. We have retraction of the nipple. Then you have appearance of the skin giving it an orangish color, that's pure diure. Then you need to have a knowledge of the lymphatic drainage of the breast for you to be able to perform radical mastectomy. Right. So in classical operation of radical mastectomy, the whole tissue, breast tissue is removed, as well as the lymph nodes and the muscles that are going to surround it, that is your pec major and pec minor. But if you're going to have a simple mastectomy, the muscles are actually going to be spared. Right. Then some lymph vessels from the inferior medial quadrant of the breast, they communicate with your subperitoneal lymphatic plexus and the subdiaphragmatic lymphatic plexuses that can provide a way for cancer cells to migrate transloamically and deposit on the ovary, producing a secondary tumor within your ovary that will then present as ovarian cancer. So that's referred to as a Krukenberg's tumor. Right. Then you may have developmental anomalies of the breast to include polythelia, that's supernumerary nipples, or you may have a retracted nipple, polymastia, the development of more than one breast along the milk line, because the milk ridge is supposed to increase in all the other regions except that in the fourth intercostal space. Then you may have gynecomastia, that is development of breast in the male, right? Then axilla and the back clinicals, you may have a collateral circulation through the scapular anastomosis. So if the subclavian and axillary arteries are blocked anyway between the first part of the subclavian and the third part of the axillary artery, the scapular anastomosis is going to serve as a potential pathway or collateral circulatory pathway for blood between the first rib and the third part of the axillary artery, right, to ensure that your upper limb boosts to have an adequate blood supply. Right. So you have the suprascapular branch of the thyroid cervical, that is a branch from the first part of your subclavian artery. Then you have the circumflex scapular artery, that is going to be a branch from the subscapular artery. Remember, the subscapular artery is going to be the largest branch of your axillary artery, and actually going to be a branch coming from the third part. Then you have the deep branch of the transverse cervical. Then you also have acromial branches that are going to form the acromial and anastomosis around the acromion process. That's going to be a branch of the thoracoacromial suprascapular, as well as the posterior circumflex humeral artery. Then you may have palpation of the axillary lymph nodes, right? So that's going to be a clinical routine or a clinical examination for breast cancer. Then you have something that is known as an axillary abscess. So an abscess in the axilla arises from infection and suppuration of your axillary lymph nodes, right? Then as for lesions of the brachial plexus, right, you're going to find that adduction of the shoulder is going to be controlled by C5. Then abduction is going to be controlled by C6 and C7. Right. Then flexion of the elbow is going to be controlled by C5 and C6. That's mainly going to be tested in the biceps myotactic reflex. Then extension of the elbow is controlled by C6 and C7. Right. Some that is known as Epps paralysis or Epps Duchenne palsy or the upper plexus injury. So it is caused by the excessive increase in the angle between the head and the shoulder, which may actually occur by fall from the back of the horse or landing on the shoulder or traction of the arm during birth, right? That's going to have a characteristic deformity of the limb that is known as policeman's tip or a waiter's tip, right? So in Epps paralysis, you're going to find that you're going to have adduction of the arm due to paralysis of the deltoid muscle. That's one. Two, you're going to have medial rotation due to paralysis of the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and the teres minor, which are actually going to insert onto a greater tuberosity, and those are going to be lateral rotators. Then extension of the elbow due to paralysis of your biceps brachii. Remember, the C5 fibers are going to form part of your muscular cutaneous nerve. Then you have pronation of the forearm due to paralysis of this biceps brachii, right? Then you have loss of sensation along the outer aspect of the arm due to involvement of roots of C6 spinal nerve. Then you have something that is known as Klamke's palsy. In Klamke's palsy, that's a lower plexus injury. It is caused by the hyperabduction of the arm, which may occur when one falls on an outstretched hand or an arm is actually pulled into machinery during delivery, right? That's an extended arm in breech. So the nerves of this injury will be C8 and T1 and sometimes C7, right? So you have cloyen due to paralysis of the flexors of the wrist and the fingers. Remember, C8 and T1 are going to form part of the nerve roots of the ulnar nerve, as well as part of those that are going to your median nerve, right? Then you have long loss of sensations along the major border of the forearm, the hand, as well as that of the arm. Then you have Horner syndrome that is going to be characterized by partial ptosis, meiosis, anhidrosis, and anophthalmosis, right? Then as for surgical approaches to the axilla, the axilla is approached surgically through the skin of the floor of the axilla for the excision of axillary lymph nodes, right? So the structures at risk during this procedure are your intercostal brachial nerve, which is T2 in nature, and it's going to supply the skin and the axilla. Then the long thoracic nerve, which is going to supply your serratus anterior muscle. Then the thoracodorsal nerve is going to supply your latissimus dorsi muscle, which is also an adductor. Then the thoracodorsal artery, which actually travels with that, right? Then I talked about how you can have intramuscular injections within the deltoid. Then rupture of the supraspinatus tendon. It is a common soft tissue injury in the sole shoulder region. And the patient with ruptured supraspinatus tendon, when you ask them to raise his hand above the head on the affected side, you will first tilt his body on the affected side so that the arm swings away from the body, leading to an initial abduction of 15 degrees. Then your deltoid will then kick in, right? Then injury to the axillary nerve, you have the nerve being at risk to inferior dislocations of the head of the humerus because the rotator cuff is going to be deficient inferiorly. You're going to have impaired abduction of the shoulder, loss of sensations over the lower half of the deltoid, then loss of the shoulder contour, right, because of the deltoid. Then shoulder joint complex, dislocations of the shoulder joint. Most commonly occur inferiorly because you have the cuff being deficient inferiorly, right? However, clinically it is described as anterior or posterior dislocation, indicating whether the humeral head actually has descended anterior or posterior or to the intraglenoid tubercle of the scapula and the long head of the triceps. So the dislocation is usually caused by excessive extension and lateral rotation of the humerus, right? So it's going to present as a hollow in the rounded contour of the shoulder because you're going to lose the deltoid, then the prominence of the shoulder tip, right? There's something that is known as frozen shoulder or adhesive capsulitis. So this is a clinical condition that is going to be characterized by pain and uniform limitation of all movements of the shoulder joint, though there are no radiological changes in this joint, right? It occurs due to shrinkage of the joint capsule, hence we refer to it as adhesive capsulitis. Right. Then rotator cuff disorders. So those can include calcific supraspinatus tendon, or you may have subacromial rotator cuff present over the most common cause of shoulder pain, right? So the rotator cuff is commonly injured during repetitive use of your upper limb above the horizontal level, that is in throwing sports, swimming, and weightlifting, right? So the deposition of calcium in the supraspinatus spinatus tendon is actually going to be common, right? And this calcium deposition is going to irritate the overlying subacromial base, so then you end up having subacromial basitis, right? And consequently, when the arm is abducted, the inflamed base is caught between the tendon and the acromial impingement, which causes severe pain, right? In most people, pain occurs during the 60 to 120 degrees of pain of abduction. That's referred to as painful arc syndrome, right? So the rotator cuff disorder is usually okay in males after 50 years of age, right? Then dislocations of the sternoclavicular joint are going to actually be common anteriorly as opposed to posteriorly, right? Then dislocations of the acromioclavicular joint or the true ligament of that joint, that is your acromioclavicular ligament, will result in shoulder separation. Then I talked about vena puncture and the cubital fossa. Then you may have something that is known as lymphangitis. So this is inflammation of the lymph vessels, right? Then you may have lymphedema, right? That is now you have an obstructed lymph vessel, then you have edema now, right? And the biceps reflex is tested during a physical examination by tapping the tendon of the biceps brachii by a tendon hammer with, or rather a reflex hammer, with the forearm pronated and partially extended. So you are doing the opposite actions of the biceps. Then you tap the tendon, right? So if you're going to injure the muscular cutaneous nerve, you're going to have loss of strong flexion and supination at the elbow joint. You're going to lose the biceps tendon reflex, as well as you're going to have loss of sensation along the lateral aspect of your forearm. Because remember, your muscular cutaneous nerve is going to pierce the coracobrachialis, and it's going to lie between the biceps brachii and the brachialis muscle. Then it's going to merge between the biceps brachii muscle and the brachioradialis muscle to become your lateral cutaneous nerve of the forearm. Right. Then the brachial pulse is used to auscultate for blood pressure that I talked about earlier on. Then you may have compression of the brachial artery, right, against the shaft of the humerus, or it can actually be fractured, it can actually be ruptured in supracondylar fractures, resulting in Volkmann's ischemic contracture, right? Then you may have an apparent ulnar artery in about 3% of people. It'll actually be given within the arm region, right? Then the radial pulse can be examined at the wrist or in the anatomic snuff box, right? Then Volkmann's ischemic contracture, so that's the sudden or complete occlusion of the artery, right? Or due to maybe a tight plaster cast or due to supracondylar fractures, right? So the muscles can tolerate ischemia up to 6 hours only. Thereafter, they're going to undergo a necrosis and they're going to be replaced by fibrotic tissue, right? Then the surgical side of the surgical self side of your forearm is going to be your lateral side of the anterior aspect of the forearm, right? Because you are actually going to avoid the branches of the median nerve, right? Then you may have suicide or cuts at the wrist to actually bleed out to death. So you have affected your radial artery, right? Then something that is known as elbow effusion, right? So the distension of your elbow joint due to effusion within its cavity occurs posteriorly, because remember the capsule is going to be thin anteriorly and posterior, while it's going to thicken on either side to form the lateral and the medial collateral ligament. The medial is the one that's going to have three bends, and the one on the lateral side will only have a single bend. Then dislocations of the elbow. Posterior dislocations are actually going to be more common. Remember, the capsule is actually thin posteriorly, right? There's something that is known as Nesmaid's elbow or subluxation of the head of the radius, right? That can actually occur in preschool children, right? So when the forearm is suddenly pulled in pronation, so the head of the radius comes out of the annular ligament. Remember, the annular ligament will actually encircle your radial head, but it's not attached to the radius. It's actually going to attach to your ulna. Then tennis elbow is what is known as lateral epicondylitis. So it's a clinical condition characterized by pain and tenderness over the lateral epicondyle of the humerus, right? That can be caused by sprain of the lateral collateral ligament of the elbow joint, tearing the fibers of the extensor carpi radialis brevis, or an inflamed bursa underneath the extensor carpi radialis brevis, or a strain of the common extensor tendon. That is going to be different from golfer's elbow. Golfer's elbow is actually going to be medial epicondylitis. Then student's elbow or minor's elbow, that's going to be characterized by a round fluctuating pain swelling over the olecranon. That's going to be inflammation of the subcutaneous olecranon bursa lying over your subcutaneous triangular area, on the posterior aspect of your olecranon process. Right. Then you can have nerve entrapments around the elbow. I talked about median nerve entrapment, ulnar nerve entrapment, then posterior interosseous nerve entrapment. I talked about those when I started with the clinical correlates related to nerve injuries. Right. Then as for hand and clinicals, you're going to find that a person with Down syndrome or trisomy 21 usually only has one transpalmar crease, which is referred to as your simian crease, right? Then you have something that is known as Dupuy transcontracture. So this is a progressive fibrotic condition in which the major part of the palmar upper neurus is actually affected. So you're going to find that the ring finger is most commonly affected, followed by the little finger. Then there's something that is known as trigger finger. So it is a clinical condition in which a finger gets locked in full extension and can be extended only after excessive voluntary effort, right? So that can be relieved through surgery, right? Then tenosynovitis, you're going to find that is the infection and inflammation of the synovial sheaths of the long flexor tendons. Right, so that's tenosynovitis. Then ulnar canal syndrome or Guyon's canal syndrome, you're going to compress the ulnar nerve. I talked about that earlier on. You're going to have hypostasia in the major 1.5 fingers, as well as weakness of the intrinsic muscles of the hand. Right. Then infections of the mid-palmar space, the ulnar base is considered as the inlet for infection and the lumbrical canals as the outlets of infections in your mid-palmar spaces. Right. Then pulp space infection, being the most exposed parts of your digits, the pulp spaces are going to be very, very prone to infection, right? Then the forearm space, that's your peroneal space, it can actually become infected from an infected ulnar base, because remember, they're going to communicate. And these two bases, that is your ulnar base and the radial base, and 50% of the people, they're going to communicate behind your flexor retinaculum, right? Then mallet's finger, it's going to be, or baseball finger, or cricketer's finger, whichever way you may want to call it, right? So you're going to find that the incisions of the extensor tendon into the base of the terminal phalanx may be torn by a forceful blow, right? So the distal phalanx will actually assume a flex position now. That will be referred to as mallet's finger. And something that is known as Butunia's deformity or the buttonhole deformity, right? There's going to be the opposite of a mallet finger. It's going to be characterized by flexion of the proximal interphalangeal joints, right? But you're going to have hyperextension of the distal phalanx, right? It's going to occur when the flexed PIP joint pokes through the extensor expansion, right? Then the clinical significance of your anatomic snuff box, you're going to find that you have the pulsations of the radial artery, the tenderness of the scaphoid bone in fractures can be palpated there. The cephalic vein can be used for intravenous fluids as it actually passes through the roof. Then the superficial branches of the radial nerve can be rolled over the tendon of the extensor pollicis, right? Then abnormalities of the arc of the hand. You may have a flat hand with impairment of the gripping power, right? So it's going to just be the same as a flat foot, right? Then you have infections of the subcutaneous space. The infection of the subcutaneous space is uncommon, but sometimes it may get infected after injuring your knuckles. Then there's infections to the subaponeurotic space. So the septic infection of the subaponeurotic space is generally primary following wounds of the dorsum of the hand, right? So that's all I had for the clinicals of the upper limb. Thank you for watching.
It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever.